Is evil born?
I first met Michael 17 years ago.
Michael?
Or is it raised?
These eyes see only blackness. These are the eyes of a psychopath.
On August 31st,
I know where he's going.
Witness the creation of a legend. Halloween.
Trick or treat, baby.
Rated R.
Hello, listeners past, present, and future. This is the Haddonfield Radio Trailer Park, where we take you moment by moment and frame by frame through the trailers that make us want to go to the movies. My name, as always, is Christian White.
And I'm Joe Francazio.
And today, we are going to be taking you through another Halloween franchise trailer breakdown episode. This time, Joe, why don't you tell them what two films we're going to be covering?
Sure, we're going to do Rob Zombie's Halloween from 2007, and then Rob Zombie's Halloween 2 from 2009.
Two very controversial entries in the Halloween franchise, two very divisive entries in the Halloween franchise. You have some fans that absolutely love these films and absolutely love the interesting new depth, thematic dimension that Rob Zombie brought. And then some people absolutely hate these movies. Like unflinchingly hate Rob Zombie's take on the Halloween mythos.
There's a fair number of people that are kind of half and half,
yeah,
too, because part two is very different than the first one, so it was easy to like one and not the other as well, you know?
I feel like it almost, to me, seems like Rob Zombie, if I had to guess, was more in line in the 2007. He was more in line with doing a straightforward, almost like a reimagining or a remake of John Carpenter and Deborah Hill's original Halloween from 78. But in Halloween 2 from 2009, Rob Zombie seemed to be putting a little bit more of his own individual spin on just the slasher motifs that had come before, his film.
Well, I mean, I think, you know, the first one, Zombie wanted to make that film. The second one, he had to be talked into making that
right,
film.
Right, that's a very good point to make.
And he probably figured if I'm going to do it, then he was just going to do what he wanted.
I mean, he caught a lot of flack in 2007 when he released his original version of Halloween. Again, some people right out of the gate really, really appreciated what he was doing. Rob Zombie has a very loyal fan base that are specific to Rob Zombie that came in, I think, for Rob Zombie as opposed to the Halloween franchise. Now, do I think the movies are offensive in any way? No, absolutely not. Am I the type of fan that feels that, going along with the 2007 remake, or speaking to that, the idea that you see, that you demystify Michael Myers by revealing this traumatic childhood that he had, that created the monster that became Michael Myers, that, in principle, is enough to throw some Halloween franchise fans right off the movie. And I totally get that. I, as a fan of the films, I actually really kind of found it interesting to see Michael Myers' childhood. Because even going by the 78 film, even that incarnation of Michael Myers, well, he had a childhood. He had the first, you know, 5 or 6 years of his life before he killed his sister. You know, what was going on? Well, Rob Zombie teases out that timeline a little bit and allows Michael to get to his teenage years before he kills his sister. So we see a little bit more of the evolution of Michael Myers as a young person. And so if he had gone with the John Carpenter and Deborah Hill timeline, he would only have the first 5 years of Michael's life to explore before he was a killer. So by extending out that period of childhood into how old do you think he is in 2007?
I think I was gonna say, I think I need to correct you. Michael Myers is 10 years old in
Wait, he's supposed to be 10 years old in 2007. Halloween?
In both of them, he's.
I think maybe because
maybe 2007 might be. Maybe he's supposed to be a little older, but I believe the 78 one.
Well, maybe Michael because is a 10-year-old boy. Dag Fairch, who plays young Michael Myers, to me looks so much so old that in my mind I always think of him as an older character.
He might be more of a 12. That real.
So like elementary to middle school.
Because we saw him. Yeah, because he looked like he was getting picked on by like the teenagers. The school.
I see what you're saying.
You know what I mean?
Yeah, that makes more sense.
Like, he's the freshman or the young or, grade.
But certainly he's older than 5 or 6.
Oh, yeah. I think 10 is our lowest base age for Michael in any of these movies.
So all I'm suggesting is Rob Zombie extends out the amount of time Michael had in his childhood before he was a killer to explore his development, to explore what was going on in his life, with his family life, all these stressors that were somehow creating this perfect storm that ultimately creates the Michael Myers that we all know and love. Like I said before, a lot of people feel that this demystifies the character of Michael Myers. I have this t-shirt, and the t-shirt has an image of Michael Myers on it in that quote that says, "purely and simply evil." And in that notion...
Which Michael Myers? The original?
This is the original Michael Myers. Yep. In that notion that Michael Myers was literally just, conceived and born, he was evil from the beginning. Now, I prefer that explanation and that iteration of Michael Myers.
Well, that's the vibe the original gives you.
That's right. All I'm trying to say is I'm not offended by Rob Zombie's visualization of Michael Myers as this traumatized youth who eventually becomes this monster. That there was some possibility that if Michael Myers had been raised by a quote-unquote normal family, maybe he wouldn't have become a serial mass murderer. Maybe that's the truth.
Right.
And that he wasn't just born bad.
If he was raised by a quote-unquote normal family, would he still have committed these crimes? Would the evil still be in there?
I think that the Rob Zombie version of events allows that potential to have been there.
Because, it's interesting. In Rob Zombie's version, although, you get Michael as a complete psychopath, you do get... a sense of he has love and empathy in him, though, still, to not to a lot of things, but when he doesn't kill his little sister, he holds her, he takes care of her,
he collects small animals,
he
has like a collection of pets, so he does have some sort of
ultimately though he does kill
Elvis the rat,
but even his sister, he tries to,
right?
But there is a little more of that of a broader spectrum of emotions from the Michael you're getting in
Zombies.
You can
see, like, he has affection for his mother.
Yeah.
He's not just a mute, evil child. He has dimension to his characterization. And, going back to what I was saying earlier what you corrected, you're right. I think it really is that Dag Fairch, even in Halloween 2007, he looks so big.
And, this is a big problem with Part 2. Is that, unfortunately, Dag was so much older, they decided not to use him.
Yeah, they had to recast.
And that kid that they used, it didn't work for me.
To me, he looks too much like... this. We're talking about the young Michael Myers actor from the 2009 Halloween 2. Yeah. He looks too much like a child actor. Well, whereas Dag Fairch looks almost otherworldly and looks...
But Dag,
strange. Dag has an eeriness.
He has that eeriness in his eyes, exactly. The other kid, it was almost like they cast him just based on physical attributes. But that kid could not do that eerie.
No, he didn't have that.
You didn't get that sense.
He was more of just a traditional looking young kid, little blonde kid. Much cuter kid. And in Dag Fairch, there was like something ominous about him in his... even in his appearance as a child. You could see, I think the casting is really good in 2007.
Yes.
I think across the board.
Yes.
I even really like Malcolm McDowell. Okay, let me just say this. I love the idea of Malcolm McDowell playing Loomis.
Yes.
I think in terms of just plain blanket casting, I think it's a great piece of casting. I just don't really like Rob Zombie's interpretation
of Loomis.
Of Loomis.
Right. I think Loomis was better in the first and than in the second.
Oh, in the second he's so over the top that it's almost almost comical.
It's kind of the point, but but hey, really quick, back to the date thing. Because what I'm going to do is, since we're here to talk about the trailers, right?
Yes.
One of the things I wanted to bring up about these trailers is, and I'm going to put this up on the screen so everyone can see what we're talking about, and I have it up on our screen here for you to see in the corner there. When they were doing the trailer for the second movie, or when they were starting to make the second movie, they did try to use Dake. And they brought him in to do some stuff.
Because he appears in the Halloween 2 trailer, doesn't he?
That's what we're going to put up. In the teaser for Halloween 2, you see a couple quick shots of Dag that they did shoot for part 2. And it's when they realized he just looked too much older. And so here up on the screen, I'll put up the picture of him with one of the masks. And you can see, I mean, he's not extremely older, but you can see how the face is thinning out and becoming a little more mature. Even his hands look, you know, kind of bigger and a little more manly. And so they decided not to use him. And it's interesting because then, but there's no shots in this teaser of the other kid that they cast. I don't think they had cast him yet. And then all of a sudden, when we see the actual trailer for Zombies H2, it'll be the new kid that they cast, and you don't see any of this early footage of Dag. But so there's a quick little shot of...
His name was Chase Wright Vanek.
Yeah, and I'm not trashing the kid. It's just,
he's perfectly...
He did a great...
Perfectly fine,
but...
And he does a perfectly fine job, but I just don't think you could he could step into Dag Fairch's shoes in terms of that vibe Dag Fairch naturally has.
Let's face it. I don't know if you know anything about Dag's... You know, his personal life and how he's aged over the years, and we got to see him at the H45 con.
Oh God!
Not just at his booth, but also like outside.
He's a little off the wall.
But exactly, that's what I'm saying. But even now, even just him being him, there's this weird energy around him, and I think that was even with him as a kid when he was making this movie, and you can't replicate that, you know?
Yeah.
And so it just didn't happen with the kid
in H2. I think that casting is really good in 2007, the young Michael. I have to say, even if you don't, if you don't like Halloween 2007, if you don't like Rob Zombie's vision for the Halloween franchise, you have to admit, Dag Fairch is a very captivating young performer in the role of a young Michael Myers.
Yes.
Now,
he's a great actor.
An actor that's hired, their job is to interpret the material. So he can only work with what he's given. And I think he does an excellent job portraying a childhood Michael Myers. It's just so funny to me that in my mind, I almost imagine him being like, 14 or 15.
Yeah.
But no, you're right. He was only probably a 10-year-old at that age.
Yeah.
In talking about Michael Myers as a character.
Yep.
But he's such a behemoth of a kid.
Yeah.
That
yeah.
It just, my mind, I just imagined him older.
And even, I think... During the filming of the movie, there were a couple of times where there were some big breaks, at least with using him. And then they would come back to film him, and it was amazing, even the crew, how quickly he was growing and aging within just filming the movie. You know, he was at that point where our bodies are just blowing up, you know?
Yeah, right, right.
But, you bring up a good point about whether you like Zombies, version or not. For me, this movie represents this, I don't know if there's a term that is ever going to be applied to this or maybe already has. It's something with films that I feel like it's a more modern idea. And it's this idea that, this was the, like you talk about a big swing. This was a big swing for the franchise. The original sort of Michael, they felt that sort of played itself out, and they needed to reinvent themselves, right?
Right.
So they used Zombie, who had this reputation for, what was the, you have, I can't think of the type of horror that Zombie was known for.
Okay, so
at the
in
time.
The American incarnation of this particular, the I would say from 2000 to 2010, that decade of horror, I think really got a jump start from these horror films, these extreme horror films that were coming out of France,
right,
that were part of this movement called the New French Extremity, which
right.
I've got some examples of, right, them I'm going to talk about in a minute. And that bled into the American horror movement, and it became more known as like torture porn.
Right.
And
right.
You have these directors like Eli Roth or Rob Zombie that are creating these extreme, violent, provocative horror films that sort of came to define the aughts in terms of horror filmmaking. Now, on top of that, you also have this other kind of movement of horror, the Platinum Dunes horror films. You have these three, you have Michael Bay, the big budget, blockbuster director. He partners with these two producers, Brad Fuller and Andrew Form, to create this company called Platinum Dunes. And their mission statement was to get the IPs of some of the most iconic horror franchises, Nightmare on Elm Street, Texas Chainsaw Massacre, Friday the 13th, and to basically do greatest hits versions of the film, to release,
reinvent
like
them,
So the 2003 Texas Chainsaw Massacre is released by Platinum Dunes. In 2009, you have a Friday the 13th movie. And again, these films are literally like the best of the franchise, kind of distilled down into a palatable release that could hopefully appeal to the fans of the original franchise and bring new audiences in to the IP.
So that's my point, right? So this is what's going on in cinema right now, where a lot of things are being redone, not just in the horror world, but also sci-fi was doing it a lot. Star Trek, was a big one.
Oh, of
doing
course,
that type of
yeah.
thing. So for me, there was this big thing that sort of happened. Where
it's like bringing everything into the 21st century was the thing. It was the idea.
I was such a fan of the original, Halloween, that when this came out, or the original, or Rob Zombie's first one, like, I hated it. I couldn't go along with it. It was so different. It was so extreme. All that backstory, and I think because
and you're talking about when it first came out,
because to me, it was representing at the time just the new direction. I thought this is just Michael now. This is the way he's going to be portrayed in the movies,
right,
they're doing. This is the new thing. But then as time goes on, and they move on from Rob Zombie, and we get the David Gordon Green movies. All these other franchises start doing, they had their remakes, but now they have even more. I mentioned Star Trek. I'm a big Star Trek fan. And also when those new series were starting, they all turned me off because they were so different. But now that there's so many, there's like 10 different, you're used to the idea of there being these different,
like variations?
Very, very different variations of the same theme or the same idea. And it's not, and you don't
and
have
it's
to.
It's almost like it's, like, look at Star Trek is a perfect example of it, where almost all these different branches are almost reaching out into subtly different fan bases, trying to bring more and more people into the circus tent of whatever the IP is.
So after, we got through getting other versions of Michael with David Gordon Green and stuff, and I kind of circled back to the Rob Zombie stuff, it felt far less offensive to me, and I really fell in love with the first one. Because nothing hinged on it anymore. I knew that this wasn't going to be it forever. This was just sort of a, this guy's interpretation, and then we have somebody else's with David Gordon Green, and now we're going
to
get somebody else's with the TV show that's about to be made.
It's just so important to remember a couple things about the Halloween franchise. Number one, at this period also, Mustafa Akkad had died.
Yep.
He was killed in a terrorist attack with his daughter, Rima. They died together. And then Malik Akkad, his son, basically takes over the company. And we got to remember, for the Akkads, the Halloween franchise is literally their family business.
Their bread and butter.
So Malick steps into the leadership position, and his first move off the bat is to hire Rob Zombie.
Yep.
And to bring this fresh perspective, this very contemporary perspective, contemporary to mid-2000s.
Even before they hired him, all the guys he was looking at, it was clear he was going for different. You know, he wasn't interviewing any other directors at all that
Rob
weren't
Zombie
extreme.
He had such a flavor all of his own at that time. And in his films, like, he very auteurist director, whereas you could put in, you know, 3 minutes of any Rob Zombie film, if you're a film fan, and you could say, this is a Rob Zombie movie,
right,
even if
yeah.
you haven't seen it.
Of course.
So his style and his flair and his individuality was, I think, actually quite exciting to bring in before the movie, the 2007 movie, was made. It was an exciting development, mm-hmm. because at least you have an artist and not just some, like, you know, makeshift, you know, upstart director coming in that can be bossed around by the executives. You have an actual artist in Rob Zombie coming in and bringing a new vision. Whether or not you enjoyed that vision or liked that vision when it came out, well, that's a whole different subjective bag of bones. But it was an interesting decision Malick Akkad made to hire Rob Zombie. If you look at House of a Thousand Corpses, or if you look at The Devil's Rejects, and you would have just thought of those two films, you would have probably thought, oh wow, you know, this Halloween is going to be a pretty brutal film. Because Rob Zombie's films, especially Devil's Rejects, House of a Thousand Corpses has a kind of carny, kind of almost like humor to it, but Devil's Rejects is a bleak and violent and disturbing film, and a lot. And I think Rob Zombie's two Halloween films, I think, lean closer to The Devil's Rejects than House of a Thousand Corpses, at least in that they were bleak, they were dark and violent. But a lot of people that were old school fans of the original Halloween might have felt off-put by that, because the original Halloween from 78 is a fairly bloodless affair.
Yeah.
And is much more in the Hitchcockian mode of tension and suspense.
And it did. That's part of the thing that was turning me off when I first saw it.
Its brutality?
Yeah, because, you know, I was keenly aware of the original's ability to create the fear and terror without having to, you know, have blood and guts everywhere. But that's not Rob Zombie's thing. And I mean, and it's interesting you bring up the vision, right? Because that was something I took note of between the two trailers that were released for the first movie. You know, between the teaser and the regular trailer. In the teaser for the original, or Rob Zombie's first one, they call it Rob Zombie's extreme vision of terror. And that he reinvents a legend. Now, I feel like the teaser, when we see it, is a little more trying to sell the movie based on what you know of the original. A lot of ties to the original. But by the time we get to the trailer for it, they're now, I think, it's more of a Rob Zombie trailer.
Yep.
And it changes from extreme vision of terror to now they call it his unique vision of a legendary tale.
I think of the three taglines you just mentioned that were all used, I think that's the one that really sums up Halloween 2007. A unique vision of a legendary tale. Here's the thing. Okay, here's something I wanted to say. Sometimes it's not about the story, it's about the storyteller. You know what I'm saying?
Like
you can take a great story and give it to five storytellers and basically get five stories. So sometimes what I thought was cool was Rob Zombie coming in and telling his version of the Halloween story. And I think that's what was so neat about it. And also Rob Zombie playing into the already occurring motif in the Halloween franchise of this idea of timelines and of different versions of the same story, or different filmmakers coming in and telling different versions of the Halloween story. Even what Dwight Little did in Halloween 4, while it connects back to the originals, it started its own new version of the story.
Yeah. You see,
so this is nothing new for the Halloween franchise. In fact, I would
happening.
Say it is the thing that makes the Halloween franchise so interesting to me,
yeah.
is that you can always go back to the beginning and start a brand new storyline. That these timelines allow you to constantly reinvent from the jumping point of the original film, or I think you could even start a brand new mythology with Michael Myers at its center. But I think you could do that going forward. So to me, what Rob Zombie was doing is exactly what that says, a unique vision of a legendary tale. That really appeals to me. Now, I mentioned his name earlier. But I wanted to say, I do think in the mid-2000s, there was a director who I think would have been even more suited to kind of revitalizing the Halloween franchise at that time, and that was Eli Roth. I always have thought that Eli Roth would have made such a fascinating Halloween film. And if you were going to choose an American filmmaker from the torture porn movement that could really have re-established the Halloween mythology with a more brutal tone. I'm surprised. Maybe they did approach Eli Roth. I'd be curious if they did, if Malik Akkad had approached Eli Roth at that time. But boy, I would have loved to see an Eli Roth Halloween. Any of you guys, let us know in the comments section.
Good directors.
What director from that period would you also have thought of that could have made a great Halloween film in the mid-2000s? Is there a director out there that could have done it? Let us know in the comment section. I think Eli Roth, just like I think now in 2024, I think a director like Ty West would make a great, you know, old-school Halloween franchise film now. I think he would be a perfect director, in other words, to speak to now about making another Halloween film. He's very high up on my list. And of course, Ty West most notably recently made Pearl and X, those two films with Mia Goth. And he's got a slasher film background as well, going back to, like, I know House of the Devil is not a slasher film, but it has that 70s horror vibe that would work so well within the Halloween franchise. But I think Eli Roth would have made an excellent film. Not taking away from what Rob Zombie did in his artistry, but I just think at that time, maybe Eli Roth would have been a more appropriate director for a standard, and I hate to use the word standard because it sounds limiting, but a standard slasher film. I think Eli Roth might have been even a better person to hire. But I like you said, I really like both Rob Zombie's films.
Imagine if Zombie did one and Eli Roth does part two.
Like if Eli Roth had come undone part two, would have been great.
You know, so ultimately what I'm wondering, my ultimate point in all this is, as time goes on and it is more of a normal thing in the movie world for, you know, these companies to own these franchises and to always be reinventing them over the years, which is probably just always what's going to happen now, right? And so will audiences become less offended by different interpretations once it is sort of a known thing amongst the masses that you will get multiple interpretations?
I mean, that should
be most big franchises as years goes on, and you don't, you know what I mean? It's like,
I think if you're going to reinvent any franchise, you should bring something new to it.
Of course, what is the point? Yes, of course. But that's what I'm saying. But will people be less offended, kind of like I was when this happens, because I'm thinking this is it. But as time goes on, audiences are going to expect there to be other reinterpretations, reimaginings.
You brought up David Gordon Green.
Just will they be more acceptive of it all?
How David Gordon Green and his team come in and do Halloween 2018. Halloween 2018 is a much more traditional reconnection to the past of the Halloween franchise. It certainly doesn't blaze as much of a new trail as Rob Zombie's vision of Halloween did. It was much more in line, I think, with the expectations of what the fans wanted, but yet it did bring some new ideas to the table, just maybe in a little bit more of a palatable way.
Well, but by the time you get to Kills, and audiences are definitely turned off.
Well, look at Halloween Ends.
Right? I mean, Ends. I meant to say Ends. Everyone kind of gets turned off, yet I wouldn't say you lost fans of the franchise.
Oh, absolutely.
Because
you know
they're just going to make, like, no one watched Ends and thought that was the end of the Halloween franchise.
No more Michael Myers. He's
dead. We know we're going to get something
else. Of course.
So
not only are we getting a TV series, a streaming series, I guarantee, my guess, and I've said this numerous times on Haddonfield Radio, and I'll say it again, my prediction is that we will see Michael Myers again on the big screen in 2028. Which will be the 50th anniversary.
After they finish the TV series, then they put out the movie.
Even if the TV series is continuing on its own trajectory in a streaming sense and running.
No, it'll be perfect. They do the TV series for a few years, and then those characters go on to do a movie.
And then bring those characters into the movie. They could definitely do that. But I think the next time you will see a Michael Myers-centric film, my guess will be 2028.
Yeah.
If I was looking at dates to bring it out again, that clearly that would be... Now, yes, that gives you... you could say, well, that's four or five years from now. Yeah, but we've got... They're working and developing on that streaming series, which is going to take up some of that time.
They need something to announce at the H5O convention.
I mean, that would be the perfect time to have the next cinematic release at the time of the H50 convention. And what a perfect time.
That'll be the title, H5O.
But we were talking about how in the mid-aughts,
yeah,
in all these different versions and in different incarnations of the horror genre. Another one that was very big at that time was J-horror, Japanese horror.
Mm-hmm.
Also, again,
extreme.
a lot of J-horror, yes, is supernaturally based, but still with those extreme, shocking, horrific films of that particular subgenre. You know, so there was a lot going on. Now, but for me, I think the like I mentioned before, the iteration of horror that I think most bled into the 2007 and 2009 Halloween films was the French New Extremity. And films, let me run through a few of these. In My Skin by Mariana Devan. Frontiers, Javier Gans. If you guys have not seen this movie, Frontiers, this French film. Now, look, let me just say this. If you're the type of person who says, I don't want to watch it, it has subtitles, you need to get over that hurdle. Because there are a lot of incredible international horror films from all periods that you should dive into and watch if you're a horror fan. Frontiers, which is actually spelled in an interesting way if you're looking it up, it's Frontier and then a parenthesis S in another parenthesis. So Frontiers with the S in parentheses. It's from 2007, Javier Gans, an exceptional film. There was another one called Them in 2006, Javier Palud and David Moreau. Basically almost like if you like the movie The Strangers, you would probably love this film. One of my favorite films from that movement, Julien Maury and Alexander Bustillo's classic 2007 film Inside, which is about a pregnant woman who is attacked by a woman who wants to get the baby out of her.
Mm-hmm.
And is like a slasher film, or almost like more like a giallo film. About a woman trying to steal an unborn baby out of a woman's belly. It's a horrifying movie. Another one one of my favorites, High Tension, otherwise known as Switchblade Romance, really made a big impact. That was 2003. That came out on American shores as High Tension with Cécile de France, and is an exceptional film by one of my favorite directors of that period, Alexander Aja. And I'll throw one more out there. I had one of my favorite films of all time, Martyrs, Pascal Yonge's film Martyrs, one of the greatest horror films ever made. If you haven't seen this movie Martyrs from 2008, again, right there in that Halloween, Rob Zombie's Halloween pocket, this movie Martyrs is one of the most disturbing films ever made. And if you haven't seen it, go watch it tonight. When you're done with this podcast, go get this film and watch it. And all these films were inspiring these American directors who created the torture porn movement. Now, I'm not a huge fan of that moniker, but it definitely sticks. And Rob Zombie, I think you definitely is part of that class of filmmakers. But so all I'm trying to say is there was so much going on in international horror that could, if you get into these films, they might give you a way into the Rob Zombie vision of Halloween that makes more sense. That you start to see more of where Rob Zombie was coming from in his perspective on how to reinvent the Halloween franchise. If you look at what was going on in horror at that time, some of his visionary ideas will make more sense. And suddenly these films... Look, another thing is, if you take Halloween 2007 and 2009 out of the Halloween franchise, so excise those movies, and you were to place them in the Platinum Dunes catalog, so imagine that Halloween 2007 was a Platinum Dunes film.
Yeah.
Michael Bay, Brad Fuller, and Andrew Form had hired Rob Zombie to make a Halloween film that fit into the Platinum Dunes mold. I actually think people would have loved it because it fits perfectly with what Marcus Nispel was doing with Texas Chainsaw 2003. Marcus Nispel was doing with Friday the 13th, 2009, in that they were almost like greatest hits versions of the franchises they were representing. Well, that's almost what Rob Zombie did with his film, with sprinkling in something new. But I think it almost works more as like a Platinum Dunes film. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, that's what you're saying. It was in that... That's what everyone was doing around that time, right?
This idea of reinventing with these contemporary directors who are doing exciting things with the genre, and it almost fits in perfectly with what they were doing with Platinum Dunes. And it's funny that Michael Myers was the only character of those main iconic 70s and 80s characters that Platinum Dunes didn't get the rights to. He's the only one. I would imagine they would have had to have tried. It's amazing to me that Michael Bay was able to get Jason and Freddy at the same time under their banner.
Yeah.
Because they had, I think it was Paramount that was funding Platinum Dunes. So they had, and Michael Bay had a lot of cachet in the early 2000s. He kind of could get whatever he wanted. So I always like to think of the Rob Zombie films almost like they could have been Platinum Dunes films.
Well, and the numbers tell you the tale, too. No matter what people want to say about at least the first one, it's the fourth highest grossing Halloween movie, behind the David Gordon Green trilogy.
The 2007 Halloween film by Rob Zombie made $80 million.
On a $15 million budget.
It made $80 million. So, that's a success.
Yeah. I mean, even the second one's right in the middle. It's still, you know, $15 million budget. It only made 33 change.
Wow, what a decline.
Right, but it's still right in the middle. Above most of the original Halloween movies, you know?
I said in our original Haddonfield Radio episode, which would have been episode 10, when we talked about Halloween 2 from 2009, I actually prefer it because it's a bigger swing. I find it to be more Rob Zombie's vision than Rob Zombie trying to interpret a franchise vision. I think Rob Zombie was more trying to kind of do a Halloween film with 2007. And in 2009, he was doing a Rob Zombie film that just happened to have Michael Myers in it. It just feels more Rob Zombie to me.
Oh, it definitely feels more Rob Zombie, but maybe too Rob Zombie. I don't know.
I can see that, and I understand that, but I actually prefer the 2009, and I know I'm in the vast minority on that, and I've said this for as long as we've been doing these shows. I think 2009 Halloween 2 appeals to me more, simply because to me it feels more like the artist vision, even though... As Joe pointed out at the beginning of this episode, and you have to keep it into the contextual understanding of this movie, they had to basically twist Rob Zombie's arm.
Yeah, he did. He said no a lot to it.
And they went, and believe it or not, Malik Akkad approached some of those French filmmakers that I mentioned in that French New Extremity movement to come in. I believe Bustillo and Maury, who made Inside, at one point or another, they were involved in talks to potentially do that 2009 Halloween 2. Mm-hmm. So you can see Malik Akkad was distinctly under the impression that there was something working in those French films that he wanted to exploit and bring that energy into the Halloween into the Halloween franchise, and I still think that it was interesting that they got Rob Zombie to come back, and yet to me he makes much more of a distinct vision, his own distinct vision with 2009.
Yeah, well, but also the numbers tell the tale.
I mean, it lost.
Yeah.
It's amazing that it lost $50 million of box office.
Exactly.
Within only 2 years.
Yeah.
Now, why do you think there was such a drastic drop off? Like, why do you think?
I don't know.
Do you think it was the marketing?
Word of mouth. It happens, you know, affects things.
The fans didn't like the vision.
But even the reviews, you know, all that stuff that comes out ahead of time, all those guys would have been pointing out how weird and different this is, you know? And who knows what else, what were the other movies coming out in 2009?
The 2009 Halloween 2, it is so surreal.
It really is.
It has this dreamlike, almost like music video imagery. That would feel much more at home, I think, in a Rob Zombie music video than in a Halloween film. And yet, when I was revisiting it, when we were researching episode 10 of Haddonfield Radio to do Halloween 2 2009, I started to realize that I kind of felt an affection for some of that kind of mid-2000s music video imagery. It has those, like, pumpkin people, the pumpkin head people.
It's not interesting.
Dreamlike,
it's just
strange, dreamlike imagery.
Yeah.
And dreams play a very big part in the story, the in-universe story of Halloween 2.
You know, when it's the same director as the first one, and I know you're going to always try some new things, but it's so different. You know, it's from the same guy. If he had dabbled a little more in the surreal in the first one, then maybe it wouldn't have turned people off in the second one if they went into it maybe expecting it. But, you know, the first one is pretty straightforward in terms of reality.
Second half of the 2007 film, inarguably, is a remake of Carpenter's original, Carpenter and Deborah Hill's original.
And that puts audiences at ease, too. When you, even though you're going to have some new scenes and new bits and pieces in the movie, you kind of feel that, you know, along, you sense what's happening because you know the original, and he's riffing off of all these same images and scenes and music cues and stuff. But by the second one, besides some of the hospital stuff, it's pretty much on its, you're not making any connections.
Yeah, he like brings in a few, you know? It almost feels like the hospital elements are brought in specifically to just give you a little kind of something to lean on in terms of what you loved about 1981's Halloween 2.
But
it seems sort of inconsequential,
and it seems
to the greater plot.
Talking about the trailers, again, when we show these, you're going to see a teaser and then the actual trailer for each of these. The teaser for H2 is definitely cut to play on the audience's knowledge or love for the original H2. It's only featuring shots from the hospital stuff. It's only showing
which you might expect if you're saying, okay, this is a continuation of the original remake of the original storyline.
Yeah.
So it's going to be in the hospital.
You don't see any of the weird surreal stuff.
No.
You know, it's much more under the ideas you think he might be approaching the second one like the first one.
And in
where
some ways
we're back
he does.
In the hospital and and Laurie on her own and Michael's still there.
The aspect that Rob Zombie chooses to continue thematically actually is this idea that you're inside the subconscious or the mind of Michael Myers.
Yeah, right from the get-go, he puts you in dream worlds or, you know, of Laurie and...
And you could say, as an argument, you could say, hey, look, this is Rob Zombie finding a way to play with these subjective perspective ideas that Carpenter and Deborah Hill set up in the 78 original that's so important to the DNA of that original film. Except instead of being literally behind the mask in the way that Carpenter and Deborah Hill put you in the driver's seat of Michael Myers, Rob Zombie simply puts you into his mind.
Yes, but, you know, so... But I think it's a combination of things with H2 in terms of zombies H2 and how it goes wrong. You can talk all day about zombies' choices. They're obviously extreme for part two, but it's sort of that mix of all the ingredients, right? I feel like just isn't as strong with part two. The acting, the...
See, I would disagree.
Huh.
I would completely disagree right on that point. We'll go point by point.
Okay. But, you know, like, well, we were bringing up earlier, that kid who, the change in the small Michael, I'm sorry, but Sherry Moon Zombie is cringy.
Well, you don't see her acting in anybody else's movies except for her husband.
Exactly.
Look.
McDowell's over the top.
I don't like picking on any artist, but I think... To me, I don't think Sherry Moon Zombie has a lot of charisma as an actor. But I understand Rob Zombie. I get
accept
it.
Her. I accept her way more in the first one. That's what I'm saying.
I agree.
Like at times.
On that point, I totally agree.
At times, she does it. At times, there are scenes I buy the stressed out mom type of thing, especially the opening scene in the kitchen. I actually think she's really good in that, right?
In terms of the acting in the 2009 Halloween 2, I think Scout Taylor Compton is really great. I know you disagree with me on this. I know that a lot of people say she's just hysterical from moment one till the end credits. She's just in a state of hysteric. But how else would you be?
Well, again, I'm not knocking
what
her
would,
on this.
What,
this
what,
is,
what would your mindset be if you lived
character.
Through the 2007 events? You would be a mess.
You
and
would
I think,
be, but you don't, as a, when you're making a film, a fictional tale, you don't always have to portray everything, you know.
I understand.
To the T.
I think what Rob Zombie does that's interesting in the Halloween 2 in 2009 is he splits the Laurie Strode character in half. And he gives half of Laurie Strode's attributes actually to Scout Taylor Compton's Laurie Strode,
right.
And half of the original Laurie Strode's attributes go to Annie Brackett's character, played by Danielle Harris. Now, I'm speaking specifically of 2009 Halloween 2, and I think don't you see sort of what I'm saying?
No, I see exactly what you're
because
saying.
Because Annie Brackett's characterization via Danielle Harris's performance and Rob Zombie's directing and writing, it elevates in Halloween 2. She becomes has much more agency in Halloween 2. And in a lot of what you would expect from the Laurie Strode character actually goes to the Annie Brackett character, which is kind of unique. But I still think that Scout Taylor Compton does a very fascinating job of depicting extreme trauma. Extreme psychological trauma, which is what Laurie Strode goes through in the 2007 Halloween, is what she lives through. Brad Dourif is also, I think, I love his characterization of Sheriff Brackett in Halloween 2. I love the kind of weird, disturbed family dynamic between Sheriff Brackett, his daughter, and Laurie Strode, who are all living together in Halloween 2.
Yeah.
They have this bizarre, they live in this bizarre, disheveled, spray-paint graffitied house.
It's just her room, right? So it's almost like they have had to let Laurie just do whatever
like
she wants.
Like, work out her issues
just,
in her room.
Yeah, you just, you know, whatever weirdness you want to do.
Her room looks like a Rob Zombie wet dream.
And they just sort of all have to exist around
her bedroom.
And let it happen, you know? Yeah,
right, right. I don't know. I just think the acting is good. I think...
Well, I'm not saying every single actor stinks. It's sort of the, you know,
the
as
characterization
a
of Loomis goes off the rails in 2009
There's
Halloween
a little
2.
More of that feel of almost... Everyone is sort of like a character actor around like the main ones.
Well, that's like Rob Zombie's
MO.
It is,
but it feels a little feels
like he brings in all these like character actors from the past that do
the
sort of take
record shop owner.
It sort of takes you. It's like Martin Mull, isn't it? Martin Mull?
No, it's
Howard
Hessman.
Howard Hessman. That's who it is. And it does. Every time you see one of these cult actors from the 70s, it sort of takes you out of the story. Oh, look who it is! Oh, look who it is!
But sometimes when they play it like. Oh God! Like when Mickey Dolan shows up, right?
Right.
That's good. You know what I'm saying? But not Howard Hessman. I don't know, but you know what I mean? Sometimes it works, sometimes it doesn't.
Are you a fan of the Monkees? I can't remember.
I love
Oh, you
the
love
Monkees.
The Monkees. I couldn't remember. It's, I knew it was either you loved it or you hated it.
No, I love the Monkees.
So you love the Monkees. Now, did
I
you
do.
Ever meet any of the Monkees? I feel like there's
I
some story where
not.
You've met a Monkee.
No, I actually haven't. No.
No, that's I'm shocked.
Yeah.
I feel like in my version of your life, at one point or another, you met one of the Monkees.
I would have only wanted to meet Mike Nesmith, and now that he's passed, it's...
Wait, know. He's dead?
Oh, boy. Yes. Yeah, he died. I think right after COVID.
So who is it? Just Peter Tork?
Nope, he's dead as well.
No, he isn't.
It is just Dolenz, Mickey Dolenz.
Wait a minute. Who is the lead singer? Davy Jones. Well, he's dead?
Yeah. He died a long time ago.
No, he didn't.
Yeah, he did.
Just to let you guys know, in case you're a listener from the future, we're recording this in 2024, and specifically the beginning of April 2024. I did not know that most of the Monkees were dead.
Yes.
Yes. Is Mickey Dolenz still alive?
Yeah, he's the one that is still alive.
So he's the only Monkee
only
left
one.
In
only
2024.
One. Yeah.
Jesus. Yeah. Well, that's grim. It's very grim.
Anyway. So listen, we should start
jump
approaching
into the trailer.
So one thing I want to point out, we're going to watch the teaser and the actual trailer for the first 2007 Rob Zombie's Halloween. And like a lot of movies, the teaser has things in it that don't end up in the actual movie. And then there's some big differences in what they do with each between the teaser and trailer in terms of the marketing. But it's...
Can I make one quick point about the marketing? Something I lost my train of thought earlier, but I wanted to throw it out there. Think about the original 1978. Now, at that time when John Carpenter was making that, he wasn't John Carpenter yet. He had made Assault on Precinct 13, and he had made Dark Star, which is essentially like a student film.
Yeah.
So he wasn't a master of horror John Carpenter yet, and he makes it in his contract that he wants the movie to actually be titled John Carpenter's Halloween.
Right.
I think what they should have done in the 2007 film to distinctly separate this from the original, that it is not jumping off from the original 78 film like a lot of the other timelines, I would have called this film Rob Zombie's Halloween.
It is.
But I would have called it that on screen. Like the marketing, the way the marketing says John Carpenter's Halloween, to the point where you can even get these really cool t-shirts now that say Deborah Hill's Halloween.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
I think it should have been titled specifically in the marketing Rob Zombie's Halloween.
Everything, but I don't know if the title screen on the actual movie, but that's
but
even
that's
there.
What, like Rob, that's every, what was making me think of it,
well,
was
every,
seeing
yeah,
it on the
it
screen
is.
In the trailer.
It is. I think a lot of the posters,
that,
it's
I think
small.
Would have set audiences to expect that this was a new vision.
Well, most of them, what it says is a Rob Zombie film over it all the time.
But you know how it says John Carpenter's Halloween?
Should, it would have been cool for
this
a little
would have been cool
exact,
to say
yeah.
Rob Zombie, since as a director, he was a brand. By 2007, Rob Zombie was absolutely a brand in terms of music, in terms of art, and in terms of cinema. And so that's all I'm saying. The branding of this film in the marketing, I think that's what I would have done differently.
Yeah, we've done exactly.
But what we should do now is let's jump in. So you're saying we're going to watch the teaser.
Teaser and trailer. So some things to look for are like you see in them the scene with young Michael and the rat, his pet rat.
Elvis.
In the actual cut of the movie, you don't really see him like kill or harm the rat, you just sort of see him play with it, and then you see him cleaning his scalpel off.
Right.
You'll notice in
the
trailer...
So it gives you the idea that he killed the rat.
But in the trailer, you'll see him putting the scalpel to the rat.
Oh, great.
No, he doesn't. You don't see it hurt him, but you see him start like rub it against it. You'll also notice that there's this really cool difference between the teaser and the trailer where that shot right after they get Michael, young Michael, into the police car and they kind of pan over to him and he's looking out the window. In the trailer, they do this cool effect where they overlay the Michael Myers mask over Dag's face for like a split second. And I thought it was interesting that in the teaser, what you see there, I'll put up a still so you guys can see this. In the teaser, you'll see they put up the Rob Zombie Michael mask over his face. But then when they put out the official trailer for the movie, they've changed it to the original.
It almost looks like it's like mask, a Photoshop the job.
It is. It's an effect. I had to catch a split second.
It looks so two-dimensional to me, but yeah. I guess if it's being used as a split second.
Yeah, you'll see it. It's like a flash.
I thought it was interesting, but when you see it frozen in time as a still, it almost looks ridiculous.
I just thought it was an interesting choice that they went back. I thought it would almost be the other way around, if anything.
Yeah.
And then you'll notice, you know, that I feel like the teaser's playing more on the Carpenter feel, and you're seeing a lot of the recognizable things that they recreated from the original. The music, Carpenter's music is used in it, like kind of in the beginning from the get-go, where when they put out the official trailer, you don't hear the music until the title at the very end. And I'm a little wishy-washy about whether that's kind of effective or not.
Right.
Because that music really brings you into it all. And then you'll notice that in the teaser, you don't see any of the extra stuff that is from Zombie, like when Michael encounters Big Joe Grizzly or any of these scenes that are totally made up by him. Those only appear when we get to the actual trailer. And you'll also notice that the teaser doesn't show you the in-between of Michael in the hospital. It only shows you him as a kid.
Okay.
And then when he's running around in the mass killing.
Yep.
And then when you get to the trailer, they kind of fill in that gap. And of course, they're showing you Michael breaking out from the theatrical cut where he attacks the cops versus the director's cut where he just attacks the two security guards in his room.
Okay, gotcha.
You know what I mean? So, a few differences. And of course, I think there's also just a lot of different angles of things we see in the movie. They're just using some different takes or some slightly different angles of shots we've seen in the movie itself.
Okay.
And that's what I got.
So what we're going to do right now, we're going to do the teaser first, right?
We'll do the teaser and then the trailer.
Okay.
And then we'll talk before we do part two.
So we're going to watch these two trailers, the teaser, the trailer for Rob Zombie's 2007 film, Halloween, and then we'll be right back.
Inside every one of us, there exists a dark side. Most people rise above it, but some are consumed by it.
Michael?
Until there is nothing left.
No!
But pure evil.
Behind these eyes, one finds only darkness. These are the eyes of a psychopath.
This August, Rob Zombie unleashes an extreme vision of terror and reinvents a legend. Halloween.
Tonight's brutal murders was described by police as Manson-like in its viciousness.
Three people brutally murdered and a 10-year-old boy being held in custody.
Said a word for 15 years.
This summer, Rob Zombie unleashes a unique vision of a legendary tale.
Listen, be careful tonight. A lot of nutcases come out on Halloween.
Is the boogeyman real?
Why are you so obsessed with the boogeyman, Tommy?
Halloween night, the boogeyman attacks kids who don't believe.
Oh no, Tommy! Boogeyman's gonna get me!
I'm gonna cut that mask right off your face.
He's come back for his baby sister. To do what?
Okay, so there they are.
Now, I will say right off the jump.
Yeah.
I liked the trailer better than the teaser.
I keep waffling, you know?
Yeah.
It's weird. I can't remember if I saw these at some point in the theater or not, and what my feelings were. Like I said, I was kind of turned off at the time by the whole idea.
Again, I'm
such a purist about the original.
I love that they say that term that you brought up earlier, a unique vision of a legendary tale. Now, I like that because I like the idea. It's saying we're bringing a new storyteller in to tell you a story you know.
Yeah.
It's Rob Zombie telling you the Halloween mythology and the Halloween story with his flourishes. And I think the trailer does a great job of telling you that's what this is going to be. But I think the trailer, especially I was noticing in terms of Dr. Loomis, they give you the very much the Donald Pleasance version of Dr.
Sure.
They make it seem like it's just Dr. Loomis.
Yeah, yeah.
Not the more eccentric, hippie version that Malcolm McDowell actually plays.
I love the version of Loomis in Zombies movies when he is dealing with Michael as a kid.
Yeah,
I have to admit, I love that back and forth he had with Dag and all those scenes. You know, you kind of... I don't know, some of the best acting I think McDowell did as Loomis for both of these movies.
Another thing that stuck out to me, that if you put yourself in the mindset, say it's 2006 and you're in a movie theater, and you're seeing this trailer, and you see Tyler Mane in that orange mask, and now you see it primarily featured in the trailer,
in the trailer, not in the teaser.
You might say to yourself, oh my God, are they going with a different mask? Not realizing that Rob Zombie's using this mask motif in the 2007 film, where there's multiple masks.
Yeah.
It's like an evolution of masks. It's actually one of the things about the 2007 film I like the best.
Yeah.
Is that Rob Zombie really leaned into the mask motif. And when you see Michael's, his institutionalization cell, and it's essentially wall-to-wall, floor-to-ceiling, just his papier-mâché mask creation.
Well, he sets it up right from the first scene when he's in his bedroom. He's got the clown mask
on. I love it.
Like, Michael just, he does not like showing his ugliness, right?
Yeah.
In the movie.
Because that orange mask that Tyler Mane wears, I think is just as badass as it gets. I love that orange mask he wears. And I wonder if they made, like, either a toy or a figure of Michael Myers in that jumpsuit and orange mask.
That'd be cool.
Just like I love the... bandage face Michael Myers from Halloween 4.
Yeah.
And I wish they had like a figure of that, like a NECA figure of that.
Yep.
But, so it's interesting.
I waffle, you know, my gut feeling is to say I like the teaser better than the trailer. But the trailer is a better made trailer, if that makes any sense. I feel like the teaser is kind of cut like a zombie film. And then by the trailer's cut by like trailer people. And the only thing I don't like is that sort of intro, the news footage montage with the announcer talking about it. That feels very fake and kind of forced and made.
It actually feels trailery.
I wonder if the trailer people made that. I don't know. I
was going to say, I bet that they produced that for the trailer.
I can't remember if that's in the movie at all.
Like
or
someone
not.
In the office, they had say, hey, just read this
exactly.
Like a news, pretend you're a newscaster.
But besides that, the actual official trailer is a little more fun to watch and all that. I do think my one real criticism would be that they should have used the Carpenter theme a little earlier.
Well, I noticed that in the teaser and the trailer, they do bring in the theme, but it's the version of it from these movies.
Yes.
It's like that tinny sounding version of it.
Yeah.
I think for marketing materials, especially for the 2007, I think two things I would have done different. When the Halloween theme comes in, I would have had the Carpenter version. And I think I would have used the Halloween font, the more familiar font for the titling.
Yeah.
It kind of has, to me, the ones they go with, it sort of has that Lionsgate film of the mid-2000s style, where it just sort of doesn't have any style. It's just sort of a very kind of limp font where the title card comes up.
Yeah.
Where, as we all know as Halloween franchise fans, the Halloween font of the original films is so recognizable that I think I would have added those two elements just to tie it into the franchise as a whole and to appeal to the classic fans and not just like these newer audiences. But that otherwise, you know, I don't think they're offensive. I don't think that we've gone through so many trailers on this show, and these aren't either of my favorites.
No, but again, the question is, are they effective? Would they get you to go see the movie?
I would say yes.
Yeah.
Any fan of the Halloween franchise, I would say any horror fan in general, who by transitive obviously would be a Halloween fan, is going to go see, even if you didn't see a trailer, the franchise is going to bring the fans in.
$80 million
It did bring the fans in.
The teaser especially, I think, is exciting and gives you the feel that you're kind of getting something new, Halloween-y. And by the time they're doing the trailer, everyone knows what Zombie's making. It's not a surprise anymore, you know, with what this is going to be. So, they can add a bit more of the scenes that people aren't going to know.
Looking at the box office of the 2007 Halloween, so 80 million.
Yeah.
What that really tells me is it sort of deteriorates the notion that the majority of people that saw this film didn't like it. Because you don't get to $80 million unless you have a fan base.
Right.
And you don't get to $80 million even just with an existing fan base.
I wonder
had to be fans of this film that gave the film good word of mouth, in other words.
Yeah.
Because that, otherwise the film would have been a front-loaded opening weekend. You'd get like that 20, 22, 23, 24 million dollar opening weekend and say, what a big splash, a big opening weekend for a Halloween film. And then you would have had a significant, 60, 70% drop off on weekend two. You would not get, even with a 20 or 30 million dollar opening weekend, unless you get repeat business, you wouldn't get to 80 million.
Well,
so this film had to have had its fans.
And it probably it got new fans. It probably started
Absolutely.
A lot of people, who there. I mean, there's probably people who are just into these and don't care at all about the originals.
And we've said this millions of times going through the Halloween franchise in Haddonfield Radio episodes. Depending on where you came into the franchise as a fan, it's probably going to be the films that you loved the most. There's going to be people out there, even listening to this right now, that might say, hey, I don't know what you guys are talking about. Halloween 2007 is my favorite of all the films, except maybe the original.
Yeah, yeah.
Because that may be the film they first got into the franchise
were
through. Maybe they've got a good memory of seeing it in the movie theater.
Yep.
I personally, I'll be honest with you, I don't remember seeing either of the 2007 or 2009 in the theater. I actually don't remember seeing them in the theater.
I saw the first one. I mean, I was so excited. I do now. It's sort of like coming back to me. I think I remember being excited and hoping that it was going to be good because I love Halloween, but I did not. I just didn't like the first one.
Right.
Number two, and then I did not see number two till I think maybe when we were going to do the show. I think I even talked about it that I didn't watch it till then because turned off by the first one originally.
I never watched part two. So interesting about the second film in terms of its marketing, and I'm looking at it right now, that on the actual main one sheet for the 2009 Halloween 2, they don't even call it Halloween 2. They simply call it
H2.
So at this point, it's almost like they were trying to distance it from its own franchise in a way.
And yes, so I think you can sense that in between the teaser and then the actual trailer for part two, where I think the teaser is clearly being cut to play on the idea of it being sort of the way his approach from the first one is a retelling of Carpenter's first one. And I think they tried to cut the trailer for part two, making you think it was going to be the same thing, mainly with her in a hospital and Michael coming back.
The interesting thing is that Rob Zombie literally flips his own script. So in 2007, the first hour of it is really Rob Zombie's vision of Michael Myers' youth, okay? You see this deeper depiction of Michael Myers' traumatic youth. Okay. And then the second hour is like a remake of Carpenter and Hill's original. And then in the 2009, he flips it. The first part feels like a continuation of Halloween 2 from 1981,
yeah.
But that ends up only being a dream.
Yeah.
Or you know, it didn't actually happen. And then the second hour is more of Rob Zombie's own vision. You see what I'm saying?
And so when you see the trailer, I think that's when Dimension probably finally got a good look at the whole film and realized, oh, this is not like a retelling of the second one. And suddenly it's cut like it's a zombie film.
Well, that's the thing. Like
with his, you see the weird puppets and a lot of the ghost mob.
So say you go opening night to the 2009 Halloween 2. You're there opening night. For the first 30 minutes, you're probably thinking, oh, this is a remake of 81's Halloween 2. And then they pull the rug out from underneath you.
And they could have kept that up.
It's like St. Elsewhere. We're in a snow globe. It's just a dream. And here's the real movie that's a complete mindfuck. Tripped out, bizarre, pumpkin head people dancing around.
I think Dimension realized that it was so different. And they knew that they were going to catch, you know, some grief for it. But, you know, for whatever reason, they had to stick with it. But I think they knew they had to let audiences in on that a little bit before they went in to see it. Because the difference between, like, the approach with the teaser to the trailer, you'll see, it's like night and day.
Because in the first, like, 20 minutes of Halloween 2 from 2009, Michael Myers is in that Kool-Aid Man mode.
Yeah.
Like, when he literally takes his fists and destroys the guard's hut with his fists.
Yeah, yeah.
So you get this like super hero version of Michael Myers that ends up being just a dream or a trauma dream.
You want
something to that effect.
And also, like, the difference with the teasers, it clearly is showing you that we are picking up right on from that night and continuing on. You know, and then we get to the hospital. It really is trying to sort of set up a different film, or maybe the trailer company or even the studios thought it was going to be that film, and that's why they asked the trailer people to cut it in that way. But by part two, you'll see by the time you get to the trailer, you'll also see that they're trying to explain why Michael's still alive after what looked like him getting shot in the head at the end of the first one, you know?
Well, I mean, it doesn't just look like it. He is shot in the head at the end of the first one. But how many times is this? It's like, I love that the writers of these movies are always like, oh my God, how do we explain to the audience? They don't care.
Just write something stupid.
They don't care.
Have a dog pee
put
fire.
Put the knife back in his hand and let him kill people. That's why the people are in the theater. But no, I jest.
Anyway.
But anyway, why don't we jump in and
watch these
trailers for Rob Zombie's 2009 Halloween 2.
Yep.
And then again, we'll be right back to talk about them.
I killed him.
Who'd you kill, sweetie? Who'd you kill?
I killed him.
What is happening?
dead.
You've witnessed the birth of evil.
Are you a giant?
Now, the secret behind his madness will finally be revealed.
Only a river of blood can bring us together again. We are all counting on you to take us home this year. Now go have some fun.
On August 28th,
evil is here. It's walking amongst us. Michael is more evolved.
Rob Zombie.
I'm not strong enough.
Completes his extreme vision of a terrifying legend.
Kill her, baby.
Lock the place up tight. I don't want any surprises till I get there in the morning.
Six guys lift one stiff. That's one for the books.
Help! I'm trapped. Help me!
The authorities haven't been able to produce a body. Do you think Michael's alive or dead?
Will he kill again?
Let me make things clear. Michael Myers is dead. D-E-A-D.
So, how are you feeling?
Nightmares are chewing at my head again. They just seem to be getting worse.
I've had four calls about Michael Myers today, all in the space of 10 minutes.
Are you a giant?
I know he's not gonna come back just because of some stupid holiday.
I need you to call 911. We're at 15 Cherry. Maya, what's happening?
Nurse.
Evil is here.
I'm not me.
Who are you then?
I'm Michael Myers' sister.
He's gonna kill me.
It's going to be all right. It's going to be fine.
No, it's not.
All right, there we go.
Well, what a difference a trailer makes, I guess you could say. Because I thought those trailers basically sucked.
I felt like someone went like, all right, I guess we got to make a trailer for this movie.
If you're having a hard time getting through a trailer, then you're going to have a hard time with the movie. And that's too bad, because like I said, I really love Halloween 2.
The teaser, I thought, was better than the trailer.
Yep,
I agree thought it was that. Very interesting that they made sure to let you know that it was his, like, he was ending this, you know, it was like the going to be the conclusion of Zombies sort of story.
Even though they tried to develop a third one.
They did.
Without Rob Zombie.
And
a 3D version.
And then I thought it was also interesting that they're trying to tell you, they're implying that you're going to find out, you know, why Michael.
Right,
you know, but which we get it. Right? It's not like the original. We see the family trauma and mental illness that is there.
But if you were watching this trailer in say 2008 when it was being promoted, right, and you see those weird images of Sherry Moon Zombie with the white and black makeup on her face, and then you see the design of Michael Myers they decided to go with the hobo Michael look, which I'm going to go a hot take here, and I would probably say 90% of the Halloween fans listening to this will probably roll their eyes, but I like that look. I thought it was at least a cool evolution of the look that had a pragmatic basis in reality.
And that was another thing that I thought was interesting that they made sure to point out in the trailer, where you hear the quote from Dr. Loomis saying that, you know, Michael has evolved, or he's a more evolved Michael, you know. They're definitely trying to, you know, you know that this is not just him walking around in a mask anymore with a knife, you know.
This cool idea that David Gordon Green and his team kind of run with later on of Michael enmeshing himself with homeless communities in order to hide. Now, I think that's such a cool idea. That he hides within, like, the herds of homeless people, and he does that later on. He probably would have even done that in the canon of the earlier films during the periods of time where you're not seeing him in the movies.
Yeah.
I just love this idea that this is how he blends in and hides. And so that look, like I said, makes pragmatic sense. And the both the masks from Halloween 2007 and Halloween 2009 by Wayne Toth and his team, I think were great.
Yeah.
And a lot of people hate that beat up mask from Halloween 2 with all the with his Michael Myers real face peering through, but thematically for what Rob Zombie was exploring, I think it makes complete sense.
Yeah.
And it's a great
metaphor for his whole character.
That's it,
you know.
I think in that sense, and if you're not on board with it from point A, then, of course, that mask is not going to work for you.
Yeah.
And so, aesthetically, if you don't like any of this, then yeah, you're not going to like these movies. But one of the things I like about them is some of these aesthetic evolutions that were taking chances with not only the mythology that surrounds Michael Myers, but with Michael Myers himself as a character and as a design of a character.
Yeah.
Like, I like a lot of these evolutions.
I can accept it a lot more now. You know, like I keep saying, now that you know there's going to be all these different interpretations of Michael over the years, I really like it. And for that version of Michael, where we do know where his trauma comes from and everything, you know, I love that idea of him.
It's like
it's not that he at this point that he always needs to mask his face, it's that he needs that mask for his face,
right?
Because he's not really covering his face with that mask anymore, but it's I like the way he takes it in and out of a bag as he walks around, decides to kill, you know. He still needs
the
psychological effect of putting it on.
It's totemic to him.
Yeah, exactly.
It is absolutely totemic to him. It's the mask is a kind of like a psychosexual totem that unlocks this part of himself that is like monstrous.
Yeah.
And it's all connected in his psychology. And in that sense, I like a lot of these things and a lot of these ideas Rob Zombie brings to the table. And I actually think a lot of the interesting psychological ideas that Rob Zombie added into the DNA of the Halloween franchise goes on to inform some of the character ideas that are in David Gordon Green's trilogy. And I just think it's... Look, I've said before, I don't think you would have had the David Gordon Green films had you not gone through the step of Rob Zombie's films.
Yeah, I think I'd brought up in an early episode, I don't think those David Gordon Green films, or at least the first two, would feel as satisfying if you hadn't gone through all these.
That's right.
You
know,
where
agree.
You saw other interpretations and you know, even if you enjoyed zombies, but when he brings it sort of back and has just a little bit of everything, you know what I mean? Play his own style, homage to the original, homages to all these other, you know, in-betweens, it works. You know, he found a great combo.
So let's ask the questions that we ask in every one of these episodes. I'll ask you. The Halloween 2007 teaser and trailer. Let's say that you were just in a movie theater and you saw that teaser or trailer. Would it have got you to the theater?
For the first one, it did. Yes.
And what about the 2009?
It did not.
No, I would agree.
You know,
but I still would have gone to the theater to see these films. And I'm surprised. Maybe I did see them in the theater and I don't remember. But I will say that. The trailer certainly wouldn't have been the thing that would have provoked me to do so.
No.
I don't I don't. The 2009 teaser and trailer, I think, are sort of failures in terms of execution and originality and creativity. I found them to feel very stagnant.
Yeah.
And we were both saying as we were watching
the second one, especially,
we were like, how these shots are
long.
So long for a trailer.
Yeah.
It almost didn't even feel like a trailer. I felt impatient watching it. And you really should never feel that way watching a trailer.
It was almost a conscious decision to not show you tons of stuff, but to sort of linger on a few main scenes, you know what I mean?
Right, right.
And then give you some little, quick flashes here and there in between. But, me not seeing the second one didn't stem from not liking the trailer. That was just, at the time, I didn't jive with the first one.
Even the imagery you're seeing, like I said, I think that would have been a little off-putting even in 2008. When this film was being promoted, or early in 2009. I think especially to the old school day one Halloween franchise fans, that imagery must have looked very off-putting.
Yeah.
So
no,
I would give a down vote to the teaser and trailer for Halloween 2, but I would give a moderate upvote for the teaser and trailer for 2007.
Yeah. Definitely. Out of all four of these things, I enjoyed the teaser for the first one in the 2007.
Yeah, I would
agree. Most.
Yeah, I would agree with that.
That's just me.
Well, so that's it. A little extra talk about the Rob Zombie duology. There's always more to talk about with these films. So Joe and I kind of look at these Halloween trailer episodes almost in a way as supplemental episodes for the original Haddonfield Radio episodes we did when we covered these films in full. But there's always new little details and new little pieces of lore that can be uncovered.
Wouldn't it be cool if for the TV series they start bringing back all these old Halloween directors to do episodes?
Well, that if you're going to anthology style, that's one way of doing it.
Bring these people back in and let them have a little hand at things again.
I mean,
anthology, a lot of these guys just step in and do episodes of established.
And as we all know, anthology is a part of the Halloween franchise.
It is.
A small part. But if you were to attack the upcoming streaming series as you bring... Okay, here's my example. If you guys have seen it on Netflix, it's really good. It came out last year. Guillermo del Toro's series, Cabinet of Curiosities. And it's on Netflix. It's an excellent horror spooky season series. That's an anthology. I think it was like 7 or 8 or 9 episodes. And what it was is every episode is a well-known horror director just doing a one-hour, horror episode.
Nothing connected?
Nope. Each one was just different, like, spooky episodes.
But would that work with the quote-unquote Halloween title?
I think you absolutely could do that.
You
could bring in a bunch of horror filmmakers and let them tell stories set in the Halloween mythos.
Right. But, yes, it has to be tied to Michael somehow.
Oh, absolutely.
We've established
but
that.
But the great thing about the Halloween mythology is there's all these different angles. What would be cool? You could do an episode that canonically tells the Charlie Bowl story.
Yes, exactly. You can go off on these divergent tangents,
a filmmaker come in and tell the Charlie Bowl story canonically that now exists within the Halloween franchise, okay? So each episode can be a horror filmmaker or just a filmmaker or a contemporary storyteller in the film media telling a story set within the Halloween. Maybe some of them have Michael Myers, some of them are Laurie Strode stories.
Yeah.
Some of them are all different. That's the great thing. You have so much room in the Halloween universe to draw from. Mm-hmm. I think it would almost be a sad limitation to just pick one story and tell an 8-episode arc about.
It does kind of sound like they're doing that, though.
Oh, I'm sure. It's probably going to be the young Loomis story.
They keep talking. Well, we should also say we'll be talking a lot more about this whenever our next live stream happens, which we'll announce.
Yeah, we'll dive more into the Halloween.
That's when we're going to do our
conjecture
big talk about
TV.
This TV show. But anyway.
But I would love it they did the anthology. You know what? The anthology thing has been there in principle since the beginning. Carpenter and Hill, they wanted to explore this anthology idea from the beginning. So you have this opportunity with the streaming sector and the way that you deliver content to audiences through streaming now. Because we all keep calling this thing a Halloween TV show. but I think it's more specifically a Halloween streaming series, which can be a different thing.
Much more cinematic if you wanted to right. make it. You have so much more time to play with everything that they'll have to expand all sorts of ideas.
I just hope they, I would love them to go with the anthology route. And if you haven't seen it, go on Netflix and check out Cabinet of Curiosities. It is curated by, of course, one of the great horror directors of all time, Guillermo del Toro. And like Rod Serling, he comes out at the beginning of every episode and introduces each episode, or like the Crypt Keeper. And he introduces not only what the story of the episode is, but also the well-known director. And each episode is like a well-known director. It's so good. There's not one bad episode. They're all really good. When it first was airing, I actually texted Joe and said, you've got to check out this episode called The Autopsy by the director David Pryor, who made one of my favorite films, if not my favorite film so far of the 21st century, The Empty Man. And it's one of the episodes of Cabinet of Curiosities. Guys, go check this series out. It's so good. It's horror, spooky season at its best. And so, yeah, check it out.
All right. Wow.
So, yeah, anyway, we're going to be coming back next time, of course, with Haddonfield Radio, episode 19, unbelievable, where we will be covering, of course, the sixth film in the Nightmare on Elm Street franchise, Freddy's Dead, The Final Nightmare, directed by Rachel Talalay. I was going to have Joe say, but he couldn't remember.
Completely. I was literally just not even listening. I was thinking what we had coming up for the next trailer park.
The next trailer park is going to be a really exciting episode. Joe, why don't you tell them what we're going to be doing for episode 10?
I'm really excited. We're going to cover the original Alfred Hitchcock classic Psycho, and then we're going to go and see, was it Gus Van Sant?
The 1998 Gus Van Sant shot for shot remake.
Yeah.
I would argue one of the most controversial films ever made.
It's unique in its approach to doing a remake, that's for sure. You know what I mean? In terms of how exactly like he does things.
Literally, you know, remake the film.
You almost got to say then why. But
we'll get into that because I've got a counter argument.
Yes.
I have a counter-argument for Gus Van Sant's 1998 remake that might put it in a different context and might give it a different appeal.
Right.
But so we're going to...
Wait. I just watched the original and I forgot how damn good the original is.
Well, the truth is, almost everything we've ever talked about on Haddonfield Radio, on both of these series, whether it's Haddonfield Radio or the Trailer Park, it all starts with Psycho.
It does. It does.
All of this.
Obviously, his ties to the horror world, but in terms of this series, he was one of the first filmmakers.
There would be none of this if Hitchcock hadn't made Psycho.
He was one of the first guys to cut trailers himself, to say, to be the guy that's doing the trailers.
It's a fascinating exploration into trailers themselves, that era, in Alfred Hitchcock, in his influence. And it's also fascinating...
Like little movies, his trailers.
The film Psycho has got fascinating lore, and the 1998 Psycho has some fascinating lore. So if you're interested in the horror genre at all, the next episode of Trailer Park is going to be a good one.
Yep. Yep.
So, yeah, we'll be getting there for next time. But and if you're a listener in the future, I guess you can go listen to it right now, even though we haven't even made it yet. That trips me out.
I bet it's going to be good.
And if you're, like I always say, if you're a listener in the past, why are you even bothering listening to this? You're stuck in the past. You have bigger problems. But I do want to say before we conclude, if you've taken time out of your busy life and your busy schedule to listen to Joe and I babble on and on about the trailers for Halloween 2007 and Halloween 2 from 2009 by Rob Zombie, then we want you to know from the bottom, from the deepest cockle of my heart.
Oh boy.
The deepest, darkest cockle of my heart.
Is that because we talked about Daniel Harris in this episode?
That's true. One of my all-time biggest crushes. I want you to know that we appreciate you. We love you in all seriousness. We appreciate your support of our creativity here at Haddonfield Radio. We deeply appreciate you taking time out of your schedule to come and hang out and watch these trailers and talk about the Halloween franchise with us. Even if you agree or disagree with things we said, we just are so thankful that you're listening and that you're here, and that in every time we get in front of these mics, I always say this because it's true, every time we get down here in Joe's basement and get in front of these mics, we picture you guys here in the basement with us. And we do this just to reach out to other fans just like you, so we really sincerely appreciate you guys.
Thank you, guys.
We love you guys. Thank you so much for joining us for this episode of Haddonfield Radio Trailer Park. We hope you enjoyed kind of having a trip down memory lane to the mid-aughts and checking out these trailers, and also just checking out that period of horror history, which is really interesting.
So what do you think after Psycho? Are we doing the David Gordon Green trilogy as a one episode?
One episode.
Okay.
It may or may not be our season one finale of the Haddonfield Radio Trailer Park. Will be episode 11, which of course will be the David Gordon Green trilogy. That will be the next Halloween episode.
Right.
But we'll be doing Psycho next, and then we'll be doing that. And if we do an episode after that, we'll cross that bridge, but that may be the season finale.
Yeah, 11 or 12 at the most episodes. But we'll be wrapping up season one of Trailer Park
soon. But Trailer Park episode 10, the Psycho episode, don't miss this one. I'm telling you, it's going to be a good one.
I've been diving
in already and doing my notes, and I've got a lot of interesting stuff I found. So yeah, we'll jump into that next. But hopefully you found this episode interesting. If you found it interesting, or you didn't find it interesting, let us know in the comments. And do us a favor, let us know where you are listening from. We love knowing and finding out where you guys are. We are outside of Providence, Rhode Island. That's where we're recording this, and it is 2024, like we said. Where are you listening to this from? And what'd you think of the episode? And is there something we missed, a piece of information you want to add to the conversation? We love that. Let us know. So anyway, with that said, anything else?
No, I'm good.
Thank you guys. We love you guys. We really, really sincerely do love you guys and appreciate you guys. And we'll be back with more Haddonfield Radio to come. So until then, my name is Christian White.
And I'm Joe Francazio.
And have a very happy Halloween.